Good morning. A warm welcome to both parishioners and guests to St. Paul's as we celebrate the fourth Sunday of Lent. Out of respect for the celebrant of the Mass and those participating, please silence all electronics. We will be using the Mass of Wisdom today, and today's reading can be found on page 1025 in the Gather Hymnal. We encourage both parishioners and guests to join us in singing throughout the Mass. Father Scott is the celebrant for this Mass, assisted by Deacon George. As the ministers process to the altar, please let us stand to sing verses 1 and 4 of hymn number 645, Amazing Grace.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Good morning.
Good morning, Father.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries.
I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask, Blessed Mary, ever-Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
Kyrie eleison.
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Amen.
And let us pray. O God, who through your word reconcile the human race to yourself in a wonderful way, grant, we pray, that with prompt devotion and eager faith, the Christian people may hasten toward the solemn celebrations to come. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. The Lord said to Samuel, "Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I am sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem, for I have chosen my king from among his sons." As Jesse and his sons came to the sacrifice, Samuel looked at Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is here before him." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not judge from his appearance or from his lofty stature, because I have rejected him. Not as man sees does God see. Because man sees appearance, but the Lord looks into the heart." In the same way, Jesse presented 7 sons before Samuel, but Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Then Samuel asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons you have?" Jesse replied, "There is still the youngest, who is tending the sheep." Samuel said to Jesse, "Send for him. We will not begin the sacrificial banquet until he arrives here." Jesse sent and had the young man brought to them. He was a ruddy, a youth, handsome to behold, and making a splendid appearance. The Lord said, "There, anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel, with the horn of oil in his hand, anointed David in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
God.
the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for light produces every kind of goodness and righteousness and truth. Try to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the fruitless work of darkness. Rather expose them, for it is shameful to even mention the things done by them in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, "Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
As Jesus passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus answered, "Neither he nor his parents sinned. It is so that the works of God might be made visible through him. We have to do the works of the one who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made clay with the saliva and smeared the clay on his eyes and said to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. So he went and washed and came back able to see. His neighbors and those who had seen him earlier as a beggar said, "Isn't this the one who used to sit and beg?" Some said it is, but others said, "No, he just looks like him." He said, "I am." So they said to him, "How were your eyes opened?" And he replied, "The man called Jesus made clay, anointed my eyes, and told me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' So I went there and washed and was able to see." And they said to him, "Where is he?" And he said, "I don't know." They brought the one who was once blind to the Pharisees. Now Jesus had made clay and opened his eyes on a Sabbath. So then the Pharisees also asked him how he was able to see. He said to them, "He put clay on my eyes and I washed and now I can see." So some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, because he does not keep the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a sinful man do such signs?" And there was division among them. So they said to the blind man again, "What do you have to say about him since he opened your eyes?" And he said, "He is a prophet." Now the Jews did not believe that he had been blind and gained his sight until they summoned the parents of the one who gained his sight. They asked him, "Is this your son, who you say was born blind? How does he now see?" His parents answered and said, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind. We do not know how he now sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He's of age. He can speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone acknowledged him as the Christ, he would be expelled from the synagogue. For this reason, his parents said, "He is of age, question him." So a second time they called the man who had been blind and said to him, "Give God the praise. We know that this man is a sinner." He replied, "If he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know is that I was blind and now I see." So they said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" And he answered them, "I told you already and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples too?" They ridiculed him and said, "You are that man's disciple. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but we do not know where this one is from." The man answered and said to them, "This is what is so amazing, that you do not know where he is from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if one is devout and does his will, he listens to him. It is unheard of that anyone ever opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he would not be able to do anything." They answered and said to him, "You were born totally in sin, and you are trying to teach us?" Then they threw him out. When Jesus heard that he had been thrown out, he found him and said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And he answered and said, "Who is he, sir, that I might believe in him?" Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "I do believe, Lord," and he worshiped him. Then Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see might see, and those who do see might become blind." Now some of the Pharisees who were with him heard this, and they said to him, "Surely we are not also blind, are we?" And Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you are saying, 'We see,' so your sin remains." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So I learned a very valuable but painful lesson close to 30 years ago. See, I was serving on an adult scout leader training staff, and this one weekend we were camping, and it was part of the training. And after dinner, I left the cabin where the sessions were being taught to retrieve a book that I had left in my tent. And halfway to the tent, I realized I left my flashlight back in that cabin, and I debated about whether I should go back, but I decided not to, as I rationalized with myself that I could see good enough in the dark to retrieve that book and make it back to the cabin safely. Well, on my way back, I realized that it was extremely dark that night, and I couldn't see much and far in front of me. I was essentially walking blinded. But I knew I was getting close to the cabin when I walked directly into one of the upright posts on the porch. It's a good thing I have a hard head. But the lesson I learned that night was always walk in the light for your physical safety. Today's scripture readings, where they talk about light, they talk about darkness, they talk about the gift of sight. Not in regards to our physical safety, but in terms of our spiritual health. There are several messages in the scripture readings today. The first is that humans, we as humans, we see physical appearances and we make decisions on what we see. But God's different. God looks directly into the depth of the human heart and makes decisions on what he sees, not on the physical appearances that we as humans see. In the first reading today, we hear how God sent his prophet Samuel to anoint King Saul's replacement. Remember, God wasn't pleased with Saul at this point. God wanted one of Jesse's sons to be the next king. So Jesse, he presents his older sons, and they appear to have the dignity and the physical characteristics of great leaders.
But God, who has the ability to see into each person's mind, to see into each person's heart, guided Samuel to anoint David, the youngest son, a shepherd boy, to be the next king. And in anointing David, the darkness of human standards give way to the penetrating light of God's insight, of God's decisions. God chose the youngest son, and God continues throughout history to choose the lowly to confront the mighty. In St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians, the second reading we heard today, he reminds us to live as children of the light. For what is done in daylight is unobstructed for all to see. It is in darkness that offers the opportunities for hidden and unseemly activities. Light is so important for unmasking sinful activity. Once exposed to light, sinful works, well, it just loses their force. The Ephesians lived once without faith, but through baptism, they had been enlightened. Their actions, their works must now correspond to the new life in the light of Christ. Just as we who are baptized receive the light of Christ, that light, and are called to keep the light of Christ burning brightly until we are called home to our Heavenly Father, we're also called to be bearers of that light of Christ to everyone, so that others can see the light of Christ within our lives. And John's gospel reading today, it's a beautiful writing. It's a masterpiece, highlighting the power and the love that Jesus has for all of his children. Jesus is present in all the sacraments that we receive, because the sacraments are actions of Jesus Christ. But we cannot physically see Jesus in any of the sacraments that we receive. The blind man in today's gospel also could not see Jesus, but he was still healed at the hands of Jesus. Faith was an integral part of the man's healing, for if he had not trusted Jesus, he would have spent the remainder of his life unable to see. In the sacrament of baptism, Jesus is present, using the priest or the deacon along with water to give the gift of divine life to one of the Father's children. This blind man today was so ready to come to Jesus, so ready to be healed, so ready to be saved. The man's gratitude was boundless as he unhesitantly responded to his opponents, the Pharisees. For the Pharisees had knowledge of Scripture, they had knowledge of theology. They were the teachers of Israel. Hence, they had sight that the blind man did not have. But their sight led them into an ever deeper darkness. They accused Jesus of sinning. The Son of God incarnate without sin, they accused him of sin? The Pharisees had a disbelief that discredited Jesus and all of Jesus' actions. They also claimed to be disciples of Moses, not of disciples of Jesus. And through their words and through their actions, the Pharisees lost the light of Christ, and they became immersed in the darkness of the world. And isn't it interesting how Jesus' disciple asked him who was responsible for this man's blindness? How often do we do the same thing when something goes wrong? We ask, who's responsible for this? We demand accountability. We're looking for a logical explanation. But most of the time, that's a reasonable request. However, at times, we can become buried in our grievances. When life goes awry, when dreams crash into reality, when our expectations are diminished, we look for something or someone to blame. Now, some of us may say that the world's a mess in our opinion. We blame the political party or a cultural minority or some religious group or perhaps some government agency for the world being a mess. We can blame whatever end of the political spectrum we wish, the right, the left, the apathetic middle. We speculate that we're in the place we are because of advertising or marketing or social media. We proclaim that the world has become too tolerant, too understanding, too accepting. We place fault with the manufacturer, the sales rep, or even the delivery service. And how often do we hear it? It's the doctor, it's the nurses, it's the police, it's the teachers. They're all messing up the world. And how many times have we heard that the waitress or that printer or the driver or the contractor, the clerk, the secretary, or even the intern, they all need to be fired? But more often than we realize, we're looking for someone to take the responsibility so we can take ourselves off the hook. We find some strange satisfaction in nursing our grievances. The real problem is that while we look outside of ourselves to place blame, we don't look inside within ourselves for taking responsibility to make things right, whether we are at fault or not. We become blinded. We're walking in the darkness. To the question of who is to blame for the tragedy, the man born blind, Jesus replies, nobody. He was born blind so that God's work might be revealed in him. And Jesus does not allow us to solve our problems through assigning blame. Jesus challenges us to discern the light of God in the midst of whatever darkness we experience. And Jesus' vision of the kingdom of God, everything, even the most painful and deliberating tragedy, can become an occasion in which God's works can be revealed if we just seek resurrection rather than seeking recrimination. But that can't happen if we nurse our grievances, if we isolate ourselves in anger, if we only focus on finding someone to blame. We all suffer at times of pain, of hurt, of confusion that we have little or no control over. The challenge to us as followers of Jesus Christ is not to seek someone or something to blame, but to move beyond our anger, to move beyond our brokenness. The blind man began to see, not just through his eyes, but with faith in his heart. Those who could see with their eyes, well, they're really the ones who were blinded, and they chose to remain blind as they looked for some reason to condemn Jesus Christ. All of us have the power within us to see Jesus in faith if we choose. Or we can remain blind if we choose that option. So we do have a homework assignment this week. It involves reflecting on what is blinding us. What behaviors are keeping us in the darkness? How can we change our lives to live more in the light of Christ that we received at our baptism? How can we be the light of Christ to each other?
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
With faithful hearts, let us offer to the Lord our needs and petitions.
For church leaders, may the Holy Spirit bless them as they guide their flocks. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For lawmakers, may the God of justice guide them with wisdom and a sense of service to all. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of Ukraine, may the Holy Spirit break through the hardness of hearts that the innocent who are being harmed and killed are mutual brothers and sisters in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are absent from the life of the church, may the Lord encourage them in their faith and deliver them from doubt. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this community of worship, may the Spirit of the Lord grant us the strength and the courage to live out our faith each day. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are ill, may the Supreme Healer, Jesus Christ, bring them comfort and peace, especially Catherine Dix, Shoshani Camaro, Ann Spencer, and Mary Ann Swan. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our beloved dead, may they live in the house of the Lord forever, especially Judy Shetlett, Mary Hines, Joe Owens, Bob Robinson, and Vincent Tomonero. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions we hold in the silence of our hearts. And bless Betty Benitez, for whom this Mass is offered. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Eternal Father, all goodness comes from you. Look with kindness upon the prayers brought before you, which we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us join together in singing our offertory hymn, number 590, Christ Be Our Light, number 590.
Your church gather today.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
We place before you with joy these offerings, which bring eternal remedy, O Lord, praying that we may both faithfully revere them and present them to you as is fitting, for the salvation of all the world. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen. And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. By the mystery of the Incarnation, he has led the human race that walked in darkness into the radiance of the faith, and has brought those born in slavery to ancient sin through the waters of regeneration to make them your adopted children. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we, with all the hosts of angels, cry out and without end acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, plenitude et terra, gloria tua.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and William our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And let us now offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are they called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Let's all join together in singing our communion hymn, number 950, Take and Eat, number 950.
Take and drink. thanksgiving for Mary's yes, let us say, Hail
Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and in the hour of our death. Amen.
And let us pray.
O God, who enlighten everyone who comes into this world, illuminate our hearts, we pray, with the splendor of your grace, that we may always ponder what is worthy and pleasing to your majesty, and love you in all sincerity. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Good morning. My name is Bill Ehrman, and I serve on the Pastoral Council. Here are the announcements for the fourth Sunday in Lent. The Poor Box this weekend will support Columbia Pregnancy Center, helping families before, during, and after pregnancy. Please see the bulletin for Lenten activities for the pastorate, including reconciliation opportunities throughout Lent. The April anniversary blessing will be held on Saturday, April 1st at the 8 a.m. daily mass. Please call the parish office to add your name to the anniversary list. The St. Agnes Knights of Columbus will be hosting a family movie day on Saturday, April 1st from 2:30 to 5 p.m. with food, raffles, and prizes for the children. The movie is The Chronicle of Narnia, The Lion, The Witch and the Wardrobe. Please see the bulletin for details. And I will be available after Mass in the Narthex if you would like to speak to me about the council.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
Look upon those who call to you, O Lord, and sustain the weak. Give life by your unfailing light to those who walk in the shadow of death, and bring those rescued by your mercy from every evil to reach the highest good. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord with your life.
Thanks be to God. Have a good day, everybody.
Thank you, Father.
Let us all join together in singing our closing hymn, number 593. I want to walk as a child of the light. Number 593. We will sing verses 1 and 2.